Yeah, okay, so we shall begin now. So welcome everyone. So today I'm going to deliver the second talk on the game theory talk series, which is presented by the Recreational Mathematics Club, IIT Kharagpur. And today's topic would be Nash equilibrium, which is a very central and pivotal concept in game theory. So the last session was an introduction to the ideas of game theory, and the talk began with a casual discussion on some of the games which involved strategic win or decision making, and we started with some logical reasoning and basic mental ability to find the outcome or the winning strategies in some cases, and then we formally stated the basic representation and the ideas or the mathematical notations used in game theory. And so today's topic is on Nash equilibrium, and since it's a bit more mathematically involved, I'd encourage everyone to ask doubts if they do not follow every part, and also encourage to keep a notepad aside with you so that you can follow all the steps by yourself if you do not get something. Okay, so I'll start with a quick recap of the last session. So we define the idea of a strategic form game. So it's basically a mathematical model or an abstraction of a real world scenario where decision making by large number of players, like more than two players, is involved, right? So, and a strategic form game is defined as a tuple where n is the number of players or the number of people involved in the decision making. So n is the set of the players, and each one has a set of actions that he can choose from, and which is denoted by the strategy sets of each of the players. So S1 to SN are the strategy sets of each of the players, 1 to N, right? Now, so since it's a game, so we can expect each player to have some outcome after the game is completed. So the idea of a utility is basically to express quantitatively, like, how much gain or output a person. Just a second, someone is waiting in the lobby, I guess.
I'll take care of this, you continue.
Yeah, okay. Yeah. Yeah, so we define the idea of utility as a mathematical way of representing the gains or the payoff that a person gets when a game is completed, given that the players choose this strategy from the like the Cartesian product of all the strategy sets. So it's basically a mapping from the Cartesian product of the strategy sets of each of the players to the real, to the set of real numbers, right? And we introduce the idea of best response strategy. So suppose we consider any player, the ith player, then for him, a strategy profile S minus I, a strategy SI is his best response strategy. If we choose a particular strategy profile for all the players excluding the ith player S minus I, so s minus I is basically denoting the strategy profile that it's basically denoting the strategy profile of all the players excluding the ith player. So for a player I, his best response strategy would be that strategy that gives a utility that's greater than or equal to the utility in case he chooses any other strategy from his strategy set. And this should hold for any such strategy that he chooses from the strategy set. So, like, basically, in a simplistic manner, if we decide a particular strategy of all the players excluding the ith player, and then we consider the best response strategy for that ith player, it would be that strategy that gives the maximum utility for that player. So, any doubt till this point, or should I move ahead? Okay, so seeing none, I'll move on. So now I'll introduce the idea of dominant strategy equilibria. So there are three kinds of dominant strategy equilibria essentially: a strong dominant strategy equilibrium, a weak dominant strategy equilibrium, and a very weak dominant strategy equilibrium. So we'll start with strong dominance. So there are three definitions for each of the types of dominance. First is strongly dominated strategy for a player. Second is strongly dominant strategy for a player, and then this one is considering the entire set of players. It's a strongly dominant strategy equilibrium, and same goes for weakly dominated, weakly dominant, and weakly dominant strategy equilibrium, as well as for very weakly, right? So let's start with strongly dominated strategy. So we are considering a player and considering two of his strategies from his strategy set. Let them be SI dash and SI. So we say that a strategy SI dash for the player is his strongly dominated strategy SI if the utility that the player achieves when he plays the strategy SI dash is greater than the utility that he achieves when he plays the other strategy SI. And this should be true irrespective of what the other players are choosing. So for all strategies of the other players belonging to the strategy set of the other players, excluding that player. So this is what is meant by strongly dominated strategy. When we are comparing two strategies, the one is strongly dominated if it gives better utility than the other one for all strategies of the other players. And a strongly dominant strategy, so this definition is basically an extension of the first definition of strongly dominated strategy. So for a player, the strategy SI star from his strategy set is a strongly dominant strategy for that player if that strategy is the strongly dominated strategy when we compare it to any other strategy of that player. So like this inequality should hold for every pair such that the first one is SI dash or SI star in this case, and the second one can be any strategy from the strategy set of the player I. And keeping in mind that this is irrespective of what the other players choose, right? So basically, in simplistic terms, a strongly dominant strategy for a player is strictly better than any other strategy irrespective of what the other players choose. Player's strategies are. So when a person chooses such a strategy, his output or his gain would always be better, right? Now, strongly dominant strategy equilibrium. So the difference is when we were considering strongly dominant strategy or strongly dominated strategy, we were considering a single player and comparing the strategies that he has from his strategy set. Now, a strongly dominant strategy equilibrium is a strategy profile. That is, we are considering a set of strategies chosen by each of the players. And the strategies are such that for each player, his chosen strategy is the strongly dominant strategy of that player. Okay, so, and like we can logically argue, assuming that all players are rational, that if a strongly dominant strategy exists for a player in a game, then he would surely choose that strategy over any other strategy because it maximizes his payoff. So, like, is this definition clear or are there any doubts? Seeing none, I'd proceed further. Yeah, so the next definition is of weak dominance. So again, a weakly dominated strategy. Again, now we are again comparing two strategies for a player, SI dash and SI, and we say that the strategy SI dash weakly dominates strategy SI, or in other words, we can say that strategy SI is weakly dominated by the strategy SI dash if the following conditions hold. And what are this? That the utility that the person achieves when he chooses this strategy SI dash for some given strategy of all the other players excluding that player is greater than or equal to the strategy that the payoff or the utility that he gains when he chooses the strategy SI. And this should hold true irrespective of what the other player's strategies are. So this S minus I will contain a strategy for player 2, strategy for player 1, 2 till I minus 1 until from I plus 1 to N. But irrespective of what they are, this should hold true. And there's an extra condition, that is that this strategy SI dash, which we are calling a weakly dominant strategy, should give a higher payoff or utility than any other strategy, than the other strategy SI considering in comparison for at least one strategy set of all players excluding the IX player from the complete strategy set of all players excluding the IX player, right? So a weakly dominant strategy then is a strategy from the strategy set of a player which weakly dominates every other strategy. So in weakly dominated strategy, we are comparing two strategies and saying that first one or the like SI dash is weakly dominated strategy over SI. Here we are saying that a strategy is weakly dominant when we are comparing it with every other strategy from the strategy set of that player and saying that this strategy weakly dominates the other strategy. Okay. And similarly, the notion of weakly dominant strategy equilibrium can be defined. So that's the strategy profile S1 star till SN star, where each player's strategy is his weakly dominant strategy. Okay. Now for very weak dominance, the first condition of the weakly dominated strategy should hold. That is, it should be greater than or equal to the utility that the player gains by choosing a strategy SI dash should be greater than equal to the utility that he gains when he chooses some other strategy SI. This should be true for all strategy profiles of all the other players excluding the IH player. Okay. So like in simplistic terms, the weak dominance, a weakly dominated strategy for a player is one which is at least as good as any other strategy. Why? Because we have used the greater than and equal to inequality. So either it would be better or it would be equal to any other payoffs, right? So it should be at least as good as any other strategy, irrespective of what the other player's strategies are. And the second condition is, which is this one, it should be strictly better than all the other strategies for at least one strategy profile chosen by the rest of the players. Okay, so at least one of the strategy profiles should exist for the other players, right? And for very weak dominance, the idea is that a strategy is very weakly dominant strategy if it's at least as good as any other strategy, irrespective of what the other player's strategies are. So like these definitions might seem a bit confusing or daunting at this moment, but as we'll proceed through the examples, they would be more clear. So like any doubts in this part? So if none, then I shall proceed. Yeah, so we'll start with the prisoner's dilemma, which is a problem which is quite interesting problem and discussed quite commonly in game theory analysis. And we discussed this problem in the last session too. So the problem goes like this. So there are two individuals, 1 and 2, and both of them are charged of committing a crime. They are brought to a police station and then locked up in separate rooms, right? And they're being interrogated by the same police officer. And the police officer puts forth the following conditions for each one. So he says, if both of them confess, then both of them would get 5 years in jail. However, if one of them confesses while the other doesn't confess, then the one who is confessing would get only 1 year in jail, while the one who is not confessing would get 10 years in jail. However, if both of them do not confess, then each one gets 2 years in jail. Okay, so we'll start with seeing the payoff matrix, how it's constructed. So these are the strategies. The columns represent the strategies for player 2, which is not confessing and confessing. And these are the rows represent the strategies for player 1, which is confessing and non-confessing. Okay, so let's look and find out if there is a dominant strategy here, dominant strategy equilibrium here from what we've studied in the last part. Okay, so let's begin. So suppose that player 2 chooses the strategy of confessing, right? So we'll look in this column then. Then for player 1, his best strategy or one strategy that gives him the maximum payoff would be the strategy of confessing. So it would be better off confessing than not confessing when the player 2 chooses to confess. And now let's say if player 2 chooses not to confess, then again in that case, player 1 would be better off confessing because his utility would be -1 in this case and -2 when he would not confess. So like we can clearly see for player 1, such a strategy exists which when chosen, irrespective of what the other player chooses, always gives him better payoff than the other strategy. And the strategy is confessing. So it's mathematically written this way here. So U1, that is utility of player 1, when he confesses, and when the second player doesn't confess, is greater than the utility of the player 1 when he doesn't confess, while the other person also doesn't confess. And similarly, when the other person chooses to confess, when player 1 chooses to confess, his utility is greater. So clearly C is a strongly dominant strategy for player 1, right? This is what the definition of strongly dominant strategy says. And since the matrix is symmetric, so we can argue that similarly the strategy C, that is the strategy to confess, is strongly dominant strategy for player 2 as well. And so, since there are only two players and each one can choose any one of the two strategies, C, C is a strongly dominant strategy equilibrium here, right? Because the first strategy is a strongly dominant strategy of player one, that is confessing, and confessing is also the strongly dominant strategy for player two. However, if we try to look at the other possible strategy profiles, that is not both non-confessing, then it's not a strongly dominant, or for the sake, not a dominant strategy equilibrium, like not even a weakly or a very weakly dominant strategy equilibrium. How, like, we can argue this way. So suppose player 2 chooses not to confess, then player 1 would be better off confessing, right? So when, so this NC, NC doesn't hold here, because for player 1, irrespective of what the other player chooses, C is the best, is the strongly dominant strategy. Now let's analyze another game, the Bash-Ostravinsky game. So the game goes like this. Suppose there are two players, so you can consider them to be friends, and they haven't met for a very long period of time, and they are able to meet, and they want to derive utility by meeting and spending time together. Let's say, so they decide either they would go to place A or they would go to place B. So each one has two strategies. S1 equal to S2 equal to A, comma B. Now, if both of them choose the same place, then they will be able to meet and derive some utility, some positive utility. And however, if they do not meet, then they'll each be gaining zero utility, right? So they won't meet if they both choose different places. However, the first person has a preference over place A, while the second person prefers to go to place B. Okay, so this is denoted by the strategy, the payoff matrix. So these are the strategies for player 2, A and B, and these are for player 1, A and B. So when both choose to go to place A, then A gains higher utility because it was his place of preference, and he gets utility 2, while player 2 gains utility 1. However, if both of them choose different output, let's say A, B or B, A, then each of them gains 0 utility. Now, when both of them decide to go to place B, then since it was the second player's place of preference, he gets the higher utility of 2, while the other one gets a lower utility of 1. So now, if we think of the situation, then a dominant strategy equilibrium doesn't exist in this situation. Let's see how. So let's suppose player 2 chooses to go to place B. Then for player 1, the best strategy would be to go to place B. Otherwise, if he chooses to go to place A, he would gain zero utility. So when the player 2 is choosing B, the first one is also choosing B. However, when the second player is choosing strategy A, then for player 1, the best strategy is to choose A. So we can clearly see that the best strategy for player 1, which is maximizing his payoff, is depending on what the other player is choosing. However, the definition of strongly dominant strategy says that a person's such a strategy should give maximum utility irrespective of what the other player chooses. So clearly, a strongly dominant strategy doesn't exist here. Neither a weakly dominant or a very weakly dominant strategy exists. So, like, any doubts till this point?
Can you repeat why there is not a strongly dominant strategy equilibria here again?
Yeah, I'll explain again. So suppose player 2 chooses the strategy B, right?
Yes.
Then player 1 has to choose strategy B, right?
Otherwise, yes, correct.
The utility would be zero. And if player 2 chooses strategy A, then player 1 has to choose strategy A. Otherwise, if he chooses strategy B, again his utility would be zero.
Okay, got it.
Yeah, so there doesn't exist any strategy for player 1 where he can always gain higher utility irrespective of the others. Okay, so like the question is, how do we analyze such a situation then? Because the prisoner's dilemma situation was quite like conclusive and predictive. We could easily see that each one would end up confessing because each one is a rational player, right? Because it's clearly a strongly dominant strategy for each of the players, the confessing, and so they are expected to choose the strategy. So like in this game, how do we analyze such a situation? So this is where the idea of Nash equilibrium comes into picture. So it's a very important and central idea in game theory. Now, so what does Nash equilibrium say is, so it's this profile of strategies for the n player, that is S1, S2 till Sn, says that for each player, his choice of his Nash equilibrium strategy is the best response given that the rest of the players are playing their Nash equilibrium strategies. So I'd explain this with an example later. The definition may not be clear very well. And the second point is, but if a person, a particular player deviates from a Nash, from his Nash equilibrium strategy, while all the other players stick to the Nash equilibrium strategies, the player will not be better off. He may gain a utility that is equal to what he was gaining when he was playing his Nash equilibrium strategy, or he may gain a utility that is less than what he is gaining by playing his Nash equilibrium strategy, but he would never be better off if he chooses to deviate from his Nash equilibrium strategy, given that the other players do not deviate from their Nash equilibrium strategies. Okay, so this is the exact mathematical form. So if you are given a strategic form game, then this strategy profile S star, so star is denoting the equilibrium or the pure strategy Nash equilibrium here, is a pure strategy Nash equilibrium if, so we've already considered that the strategy set of all players excluding the ith player is their Nash equilibrium strategy set. So suppose we are considering the Nash equilibrium strategy for the first player, then S star minus I is essentially this set S2 star till Sn star. Okay, so the condition is that the utility that the player I gains by playing his Nash equilibrium strategy, given that the other players are playing their Nash equilibrium strategy, is always greater than equal to the utility that he would gain if he chooses some other strategy other than his Nash equilibrium strategy. And given that the other players are still choosing their Nash equilibrium strategy, and this should hold for all strategies available in the strategy set of the ith player. Okay, this is what is the same as the second point in the definition. And the another way of stating this is that suppose that UI SI S minus I star, that is, this denotes the utilities that each of the that the ith player is gaining when he chooses the respective strategy S1, S2 till whatever we present in his strategy set, and the other players are choosing their Nash equilibrium strategies, then the maximum of this would be the Nash equilibrium strategy profile for that player, which is also like evident from this, because the greater than or equal to inequality holds. So like a player may have more than one Nash equilibrium strategies in his strategy set, because the greater, if it were only greater than either there would be no such strategy or only one strategy, but because it's greater than equal to, so there could be multiple such strategies which are his Nash equilibrium strategy. Okay, so again, so this is that each player's Nash equilibrium strategy is the best response to the Nash equilibrium strategies of the player. Okay, so the difference between Nash equilibrium or pure strategy Nash equilibrium and other dominant strategy equilibrium was that for the other dominant strategy equilibrium, the condition was that the utility should be maximum or at least equal to the utility gained by any other strategy, irrespective of what the other players are choosing, right? But here, the condition is that this should hold true only when the other players are choosing their Nash equilibrium strategy. So this condition may not hold true for all possible strategy profiles of all players excluding the ith player, but this should hold true for the Nash, at least for the Nash equilibrium strategy. Okay, so it's kind of a weaker notion of equilibrium as compared to dominant strategy equilibrium. And dominant strategy equilibrium are quite conclusive because their outcomes are quite predictive. Like in the case of prisoner's dilemma, we could easily predict that each one would end up confessing because each one knew what his best strategy was, irrespective of what the other players are choosing. So such dominant strategy equilibrium, they exist in real world scenarios. They are quite desirable because they help us predict a complete outcome. However, in most practical scenarios, such a dominant strategy equilibrium doesn't exist because there are large number of interdependencies on each player's strategy with the other player's strategy. So this is why the idea of Nash equilibrium comes into picture and is important. So let's again look at the Bash-Stravinsky game with this light, with this idea of Nash equilibrium in mind. So we saw that no dominant strategy equilibrium existed for this game, So then we want to see if a Nash equilibrium, like a PSNE, a PSNE is the pure strategy Nash equilibrium, exists for this game. So how do we go about? So since the definition goes like this, that the utility for the player should be maximized when he chooses his Nash equilibrium strategy rather than when he chooses any other strategy, given that the other players choose their Nash equilibrium strategy. So if you want to compute the Nash equilibrium strategy for any ith player, we need to know what is the Nash equilibrium strategy for the other players, because then only we'll be able to calculate the utility for the player, right? So the only way is to take all possible cases or all possible strategy profiles and check this condition, right? So we have discussed only those games which have very limited number of players, so two here, and each of one has only two strategy profiles. So that gives only 2x2, only a 4 strategy profiles to be analyzed. Otherwise, it would be very computationally heavy task. So yeah, so this is the payoff matrix. So we'll start with one of the possible strategy profiles, A, A. So you can consider this that an external agent, say, tells player 1 that you choose profile A, and says to player 2 that you choose profile A, and he says that this is a Nash equilibrium. Then the players can check if it's actually a Nash equilibrium if somehow, let's say, one of the players deviates from that strategy while the other or the other players do not deviate, and he finds that by deviating from this strategy which is given to him by the external agent, or let's say by someone, if he finds that his utility is increasing by deviating from this strategy, then we can argue that it's not a Nash equilibrium strategy, because an equilibrium doesn't exist here. The player 1 would always want to change to strategy B if strategy of the player 2 is fixed, right? So this way you can argue that an equilibrium doesn't exist here in terms of what we understand about equilibrium. So let's start with A, I. So let's assume that player 2 has chosen the strategy profile A, strategy A. Then for player 1, it's best to choose strategy A. Otherwise, if he chooses strategy B, it would be gaining zero utility. Similarly, if player 1 chooses strategy A, it's best for player 2 to choose strategy A. So we can argue that A, A is actually a pure strategy Nash equilibrium. Okay. Now let's look at A, B. So let's suppose that player A is choosing strategy A. Then player 2 would be better off if he chooses strategy A rather than when he chooses strategy B, because with this scenario, player B is getting zero utility. However, if he deviates unilaterally to strategy A, he would be gaining a utility of 1. So we can say that this is not a stable strategy profile, and hence it's not a pure strategy Nash equilibrium. And similarly, we can argue for B, A, because it's a symmetric matrix and it's similar to A, B. Okay. And similarly, B, B. So let's say player 2 chooses strategy B, and player 1 has two options. He can choose strategy B or A. So this one is his Nash equilibrium strategy. However, if he deviates to strategy A, he'd be gaining lesser utility. So clearly, this is better option for him when the other player chooses strategy B. And similarly, when the player 1 chooses strategy B, for player 2, it's best to choose strategy B. So the key idea is we check if a strategy profile is a Nash equilibrium by checking unilateral deviation of each of the players. So if there were 3 players and some set of strategies, we would have considered each player unilaterally deviating from his Nash equilibrium strategy, and then find if he gains more utility, then such a profile is not a Nash equilibrium profile. However, if he chooses another strategy and he gains a utility that is equal to or less than his Nash equilibrium utility, then that can be considered as a Nash equilibrium profile. Okay, so A, and B, B are Nash equilibrium profiles, while A, B and B, A are not. So like, any doubt in this part?
Like, I would like to add on what Pranav just said. So in case someone gets confused by these terminologies, just consider in this fashion, that say some external guy has come and said to each and every player that, okay, guy number A, you do this strategy. Guy number B, you do this strategy. Guy C, do this strategy, and so on. Okay. Now, the external guy coming and ordering guys to do this thing, that has to be an equilibrium. it becomes an equilibrium when each player thinks from his own perspective and sees that, okay, say if I change my option, like I don't follow the guy, then will I get something better? And if it's the case that the person will not get something better, then that person won't deviate. So if each and every person doesn't deviate from the decision which has been told to him, then that's an equilibrium. And in this case, we call it as pure strategy Nash equilibrium. So you can consider this in that fashion. Like, I'm just trying to give an analogy. Obviously, the technical definition is something else. Yeah, but what Pranav was trying to say is this. So by unilateral deviation, what exactly we mean is that suppose rest of the players are not going, you know that remaining players are quite honest and they are not going to change their decision, and you only are going to change your decision, say, then can you get something better? And if you observe that you don't get anything better, then you stay with your decision. And if every player is staying with their decision in this mindset, then that's a pure strategy Nash equilibrium. That's what I had to add.
Yeah,
I had a question in the previous slide. So suppose for player one, there are two strategies, A and B, which are both like Nash equilibrium strategies, like they give the same utility. So then which strategy will we use to compute the best Nash equilibrium strategy for the other players? Like for player two, will you choose the first strategy for player one or the second strategy for player one?
Yeah, like then in that case, we'll have to consider each one. So like the other players, Nash equilibrium strategy would change, like could be different in each of the cases. Like when player one is choosing strategy S1, which is Nash equilibrium strategy, or when he's choosing S2 is Nash equilibrium strategy, then in either case, like these are two, these would be considered two different cases. Like in each one, the other players' Nash equilibrium strategy could come different.
Okay, got it. Thanks.
Yeah, like we'll have to consider separate cases.
Okay, understood. Thanks.
Yeah. Yeah, okay. So, if there are no more doubts, then I'll proceed further. Yeah, so we'll again look into the prisoner's dilemma problem. So, we saw that C, C was a strongly dominant strategy equilibrium profile, right? Now let's see if it's also a pure strategy Nash equilibrium profile. So if player one is choosing this, so if it, like as I'm not told, if an external agent comes and tells the two players, he says to prisoner one that you choose strategy of confessing, and says to the prisoner two also that you also confess. So then each one can check if he gets better off by changing his strategy while the other players maintain their Nash equilibrium strategy or the strategy that was prescribed by the external agent. So we can clearly see if the person B or the prisoner B maintains his strategy of confessing, then person one, if he doesn't confess, then he would end up worse off than when he was confessing. Okay, so same goes for the prisoner two also. So that's why we can argue it's a pure strategy Nash equilibrium. And similarly, we can check that all the other three strategy profiles, confessing for player one, not confessing for the prisoner two, not confessing for prisoner one, and confessing for prisoner two, and both not confessing are not PSNE. So I'll take one example. Let's say not confessing when player one chooses not to confess and player two chooses to confess. Okay. So if player two is choosing to confess, then for player one, his best strategy is to confess, because then his utility would be -5, or in other terms, he would be getting only 5 years in jail. However, if he chooses not to confess, he would get 10 years of jail. So clearly, this cannot be a pure strategy Nash equilibrium, because this player would always try to deviate and choose the strategy of confessing. Okay, so like what we can see from this example is that the PSNE ensures that every player gets the optimal output, I mean the best output, given the other players are choosing their Nash equilibrium strategies. So only if one player deviates from his strategies while the other players are not deviating from their Nash equilibrium strategies, then that player would not be better off by choosing any other strategy. However, if more than one player, say two or more players, deviate from their equilibrium strategies, then this might result in a better payoff or better gain for each of those players who have deviated, or maybe even for those players who didn't deviate from this strategy. So like we can consider the above example itself. So if only one of the players decided to not confess while the other was confessing, then that player was worse off than his situation before. However, both of them decide not to confess. Okay, so if both of them change their strategy from their PSNE and decide not to confess, then each one would be better off. So they would have to go only 2 years of jail. Okay, so this is one thing, important thing about pure strategy Nash equilibrium, that it's an insurance only against unilateral deviation. Okay, and the other thing is, so a Nash equilibrium also doesn't guarantee the most optimal or the best strategy for every player being chosen, right? So like the best strategy here would be for each of one, if both of them chose not to confess, then both of them had to spend only 2 years in jail. However, we saw that the pure strategy Nash equilibrium was C, C and not NC, NC. So this is the crux, that it doesn't guarantee the most optimal strategy for every player, but it guarantees that each player would be satisfied given the in a Nash equilibrium, given that the other players choose their Nash equilibrium strategy. So like every player is essentially satisfied simultaneously, that is at the same time, by their choices. Because if one of them changes their choice, then they would be worse off. And so like I already discussed this idea that Nash equilibrium is basically a weaker notion of equilibrium than the other three dominant strategy equilibrium. And so if a dominant strategy equilibrium exists, so we saw that C, C, that is confessing for both of the players, was a strongly dominant strategy equilibrium, right? So if it's a strongly dominant strategy equilibrium, then it has to be a pure strategy Nash equilibrium too. Like any dominant strategy equilibrium has to be a pure strategy Nash equilibrium. So I'll explain by going to the definition of the dominance. So the inequalities or the conditions were holding true for all the strategies of all the other players excluding the ith player, right? So one of the strategies in this would also be the Nash equilibrium strategy for all the other players excluding the ith player. So if this condition is satisfied, then the condition is also satisfied in case of equilibrium for strategy of the other players. And same goes for weakly dominant strategy equilibrium and very weakly dominant strategy equilibrium. So like, is this part clear, or if anyone didn't get it, I'd explain it again. So like, any doubts? Yes, so seeing none, I'd proceed further. So this is another way of like defining the idea of Nash equilibrium. So first we start with this idea of best response or respondents of a player.
I had a small doubt in that problem, a batch problem, problem. We still, like, if I am player one, I still don't know my best strategy, right?
Yeah. Like, it would be left to chance, or like we'll have to consider probabilistic terms here. Like, because player one, if he chooses strategy A and the player two chooses strategy A, then also the player one is like fine. However, if both of them choose strategy B, then also they are fine. So like, it kind of depends which one of the two Nash equilibrium strategy profile is chosen. So like, this depends on chance, or like we'll have to consider probabilistic terms here. So that would be considered in mixed strategy Nash equilibrium. So it will be introduced later.
In the definition of Nash equilibrium, I have to assume I know the Nash equilibrium strategies of the other players also, right?
Yeah.
So like, that isn't that contradictory? Like, how can I find out my Nash equilibrium?
There is nothing called Nash equilibrium strategies of other players. There is one single strategy, okay, where every player is told that what you should do. So I know that what you are going to do, okay, which is openly told to everyone. And now, after getting that information, if I assume that no one else is going to change their decision, then can I change my decision to get something better? So that is what Nash equilibrium is looking at. So Nash equilibrium is the collection of those decision of each and every player. So that no player sort of changes their decision. So that's the rough idea.
Okay, good. Thanks.
Yeah, okay, so I shall proceed then. So yeah, so the best response corresponding for a player is the set of his best response strategies for a given profile of the strategies of the other players. So like, this is a strategic form game. So for a player I, we denote his best response corresponding by small b and then subscript I, and it's a mapping from the set containing all the possible strategies of the all players excluding the ith player, and it's mapped to the power set of the strategy set of the player. So what does this essentially mean is, suppose we fix a strategy profile for all the players excluding the ith player, and we want to compute the best response correspondence for that player with this strategy profile for other players in consideration. So in that case, the condition is that the utility that the player gains by choosing a particular strategy from his strategy set should be greater than the utility that he gains by considering any other strategy from his strategy set. So all such strategies which are denoted here by small si belong to the best response corresponding of the ith player if the utility they give are greater than the utility that any other strategy of the other player gives. Okay, so I would explain with an example. So for the player, suppose for the player one, we are choosing S in the prisoner's dilemma case, we are choosing that the S minus I, that is the other player, the second player is choosing to confess, right? So in that case, S minus I is fixed to the other player confessing. So what's the best response corresponding for the player? His set of best response strategies, given that the other player chooses to confess. So the player one has only two possibilities, either to confess or not to confess, right? So, and we know his best response strategy is confessing, given that the other person is confessing, or given that the other strategy is fixed, which is confessing. So that way we can say that B of one, that is the best response corresponding for the first player, given this, given the second player chooses to confess, is the set containing only a single element, that's to confess. And again, this could have multiple elements depending on what kind of situation we are considering. Like, there could be more than one best response strategy for each player. And similarly, we are finding the best response corresponding for the second player, considering that the strategy of all the other players, excluding the second player, that is only player one in this case, is to confess. So if the player... So, like, is someone unmuted?
Oh.
Yes, I'll continue. Just a second. Yeah, so let's say if the first player, which is the strategy set S minus 2 star, chooses to confess, then for player 2, the best response corresponding, that is the set of his best response strategy, would be only to confess. So for a PSNE, a pure strategy Nash equilibrium, the condition is that this strategy profile S1 star till SN star would be a PSNE if this strategy SI star for each of the player belongs to the best response corresponding strategy of the IH player, given that the other player's strategy is their Nash equilibrium strategy. So like, again, as we discussed, so if an external agent ask each of the person that you choose this strategy, and he says to the second person that you choose this strategy and something like that. So if we first find the best response corresponding for each of the players, given that the other players are choosing this, their Nash equilibrium strategy, that is the strategy which is proposed to them by that external agent, and we are finding the set of the best response strategies for that player. And if this strategy, which is prescribed to the IH player by the external agent, belongs to this best response corresponding set, then we can say that it's a Nash equilibrium, but this should hold for every player, not just one or like only for one player. It should hold true for every each and every player, right? So like, is this definition clear? Or is this idea clear? So like, basically it's a more formal manner to describe pure strategy in Nash equilibrium in case like the prisoner's dilemma or the BOS game that we are considering contains only two members, right? So if the, even the Nash equilibrium strategies may be limited, or the best response strategy for each one could be limited. However, if there are large number of players involved and each one has large amount of large number of strategies in his hand, then this set could contain a large number of elements, right? So in that case, the belongs to, we'll have to consider the idea that this strategy, the strategy which is Nash equilibrium strategy for that player, should belong to this best response corresponding set, right? So like, if there are no other doubts, I'll move ahead. So in the prisoner's dilemma problem, we saw that if the other player, that is S minus one star, that is the other player chooses to confess, because we saw that C comma C was a pure strategy Nash equilibrium. So S minus one star is essentially the strategy set confessing. So if the other players are choosing to confess, so for player one, it's best to confess. So its set of best response strategy is to confess. And we can clearly see that S1 star, which is the Nash equilibrium strategy for that player, actually belongs to this best response correspondence to the for the player I, given that the other players are choosing their Nash equilibrium strategy. And same goes for the second player. So that's, this is how this, we saw how this definition or this idea works. Okay. So now let's look at another interesting problem, the tragedy of commons. So it's a problem which occurs quite often in real world scenarios in human or animal societies, where there's a conflict over use of resources. So like, there are quite a restricted amount of resources, and each of the players or each one of the agents in the society wants to maximize the amount of resources available for them, but at the same time they also have to keep in mind that they have to leave some amount, a bare minimum, for others as well, in order to maintain his social interest as well as to maintain the coexistence of the society. So the version that we are considering here is that a village suppose has n farmers represented by this set n equal to 1 to n, and each of them has two strategies. So they can keep a sheep or they cannot keep a sheep. And like, if a farmer keeps a sheep, he can keep only one sheep, right? So they are resource constrained, so they cannot keep more than one sheep. So each one has the strategy profile of S1 equal to S2 till Sn equal to 0, 1, where 0 denotes not keeping a sheep and 1 denotes keeping a sheep. And so if a farmer keeps a sheep, then he derives some utility, let's say by the wool that is yielded by the sheep, and this utility accounts to 1 unit. So if a farmer keeping a sheep gains a utility of 1 unit, because of the resources that the sheep provides. However, the village has a limited stretch of grassland, so that's what is the constrained resource. And so whenever a sheep grazes on this, then for every sheep that grazes, there is a damage to the environment equal to 5 units per sheep, right? And so since the damage to the environment has to be bared equally by every farmer, so like, this is the assumption that the damage to the environment is to be shared equally by each of the farmers. And it's quite logical assumption, because if there's a damage to the ecosystem in which the farmers are living, then it will not only affect those who have the sheep, but it'll also affect those who do not have the sheep. That's why this damage or this is associated with a negative utility, and it will be shared equally by every farmer. So now the utility function or the payoff function for the farmer becomes, so if we consider any arbitrary farmer I, and this is the strategy profile taken into consideration. So this is Si, which is his utility gain because of keeping a sheep or not keeping a sheep. So when this Si is zero, so there's no gain due to keeping a sheep. However, when this is one, he gains one unit due to keeping a sheep. And this is the negative utility, or say the damage that he has because of the environmental cost. So how, I hope you understood what, how this is modeled. So since the damage per sheep is 5, so 5 into, now S1 plus S2 till Sn will give us the total count of sheep, because only those strategies would add up, which have one and the others would be zero. So it would add up to the total number of sheep and divide by n, because each farmer has to equally divide the damage due to the environment. Okay, so the same notation has been reframed. So this was the summation of the strategies of each of the players from j equal to 1 to n. And so we took out this summation of, we took out the term of si for the ith player out. So this term becomes the summation from 1 to n of all the strategies excluding the ith strategy, right? So this is the utility function for the ith player. So let's consider first the case n less than 5, when there are less than 5 number of farmers. So this condition arises depending on what's the damage attributed per sheep to the environment, right? So you're considering n less than 5. If it were the damage to the environment per sheep were 5 units, say 10 units or 2 units, then we would have considered that into account, right? So case 1, when n is less than 5, so you can clearly see the utility for ith player. In the utility of the ith player, this term becomes negative, right? And this term is already negative. So if we compare the utility for the ith player, when you chooses 0 as a strategy, while considering any other strategy for any other player, just a second, I think I'm facing some issue. Yeah, hello. Yeah, so there was an issue with my network, so I'll start again. Yeah, so we are considering the case n less than 5. Yeah, so we're considering the case of n less than 5. So in this case, we can clearly see that the strategy of not choosing a sheep, so we can clearly see that the strategy of not choosing a sheep gives more payoff than the strategy of choosing a sheep, because then if this becomes 1, then this is more negative. So this whole term becomes more negative. So clearly 0 is a strongly dominant strategy for each of the players, and correspondingly 0, 0, 0 for each of the players is strongly dominant strategy equilibrium profile. And since it's a strongly dominant strategy equilibrium profile, it's also the pure strategy Nash equilibrium profile. Because you can see if a strategy profile is a equilibrium dominant equilibrium profile, it's also a PSM, right? So none of the farmers has an incentive to keep a sheep, and so the best decision for each one would be not to keep a sheep in this scenario. The second case is when the number of farmers is greater than 5, so in this case, n minus 5 by n term becomes positive. So we can clearly see that the utility when a farmer chooses to keep a sheep is greater than when the farmer chooses not to keep a sheep. And this is true irrespective of what the other player strategies are. So clearly it's a win-win strategy for each one player to choose the sheep, right? So one is a strongly dominant strategy for each of the players. So it's a strongly dominant strategy equilibrium, 1, 1 for each of the players. And it's also a pure strategy Nash equilibrium. Now the third case, which is the most interesting case, is when n equal to 5. So then this term, n minus 5 by n si, becomes 0. So the utility of each player then is same irrespective of whether he chooses to keep a sheep or whether he chooses not to keep a sheep. It's only dependent on what the other player's strategies are, and it's not at all dependent on what he chooses. So let's say we are calculating the utilities for the ith player, and we are fixing the utilities, the strategies for the other players. So each of the other players have their strategy fixed. So for player UI, if we consider that 0, comma, and the strategies of all the other players fixed is its PSNE profile, then the ith player can unilaterally deviate to strategy 1, right? and still get the same utility. So if 0, comma, all the other player strategy being fixed is a strategy profile, is a pure strategy Nash equilibrium profile, then clearly 1, comma, and all the other players having their strategy fixed is also a pure strategy Nash equilibrium profile, right? So this way, if we consider for every player in similar way, so player 1 has 2 options, player 2 has 2 options, and similarly all the n players has 2 options. So there are 2 power n possible strategy profiles, and each one would be a PSN. Because now the farmer, it doesn't matter to the farmer whether he keeps his sheep or not, because the utility is same in both the cases. So the gain that he would get because of wool will now be like, doesn't matter to him, right? So now, can you identify any dominant strategy equilibrium here in the same case, n equal to 5? If anyone has any...
There isn't one, right? Because whether he, like, whichever strategy any farmer chooses doesn't change the utility.
No, actually, there is a very weakly dominant strategy equilibrium here. So, like, if you remember, so for a very weakly dominant strategy equilibrium, the condition
shouldn't
was,
it all be zero? Like if every farmer chooses, like not to keep a cow, will that not be the PSNE?
Yeah, that is one of the possible PSNE, but we cannot surely say that that would always be the case. Why? Because suppose, like, that's what I'm saying, if we are considering the utility for player I, and suppose we choose the strategies for all the other players. Let's say that for the player 1, we are considering, and we, for all the other players, that is from player 2 to player N, we consider that each of them chose not to keep a sheep, right? So now player 1 has options either to keep a sheep or not to keep a sheep, right? So, like, it doesn't even depend on his strategy that what he would be gaining, the utility he would be gaining. So, like, it's equally probable that he chooses not to keep a sheep or to keep a sheep, right? So 0, 0, so like the other players, if you consider the other players had the strategy 0 each, so 0, 0 is one such possibility. However, 1, comma, and rest 0 for everyone else is also such a possibility, right? So, like, we cannot definitely say that 0, 0 would be the best strategy, would be the PSNE in this case. Though it's the best for each of them, right? Because then in that case, each one would be gaining zero utility. So although that is the best strategy for each of them, however, it's not the only PSNE that is possible. So this is what, like, the idea is that a PSNE may not be the most optimal strategy in terms of the gains of each of the players, right? So, like, did you get it?
Yes, so there may be more PSNEs, right?
Yeah, every profile is a PSNE here. Suppose player 1 chooses, in this case, when n equal to 5, every profile is PSNE. So, like, did you get
that? And that 0, 0, 0 is the, like, the most optimal, like, strategy. Correct, because no farmer will lose anything. Like, if even one farmer keeps a cow, then all the farmers will have negative payoff. But if all... in that PSNE where all farmers do not have a cow, no farmer incurs a loss.
Yeah, but, like, I think we cannot, like, consider it this way, because the idea of the, like, the most optimal strategy is one which gives a player better gain when we are considering a particular strategy of all the other players, right?
Correct.
So if we consider any arbitrary strategy profile of all the players excluding the ith player, then he's gaining same utility whether he chooses 1 or 0. Okay. So, like, for that person, if we consider each person individually, for that person choosing strategy 1 or 0, like, is equally likely. There's no difference between the two. So that's why, like, this argument that 0, 0, 0 is the most optimal for each one, like, may not hold. Though, like, they, if each one decides to do that, then their utility would obviously be the greatest for each one of them. But, like, we cannot surely argue that this holds. So, like, was it clear?
Yeah, okay, got it.
Yeah, and so like, so I asked this question, is there any dominant strategy equilibrium? So she answers that there isn't any dominant strategy equilibrium. So, but the correct answer is that there's a very weakly dominant strategy equilibrium here. Why? Because the condition for very weakly dominant strategy equilibrium was, let me go back to the slide. So the condition was that irrespective of what the other players are choosing, if a player has a strategy in his strategy profile that gives him a payoff greater than equal to. So this equal to part is also there. So when he's choosing the strategy 1, then he's getting the same utility as 0. And when he's choosing the strategy 0, again he's getting the same utility as strategy 1, right? So again, if he chooses 0 or 1, each one of them is his very weakly dominant strategy in this case. And this holds true for all such strategies of the other players because the n equal to 5 condition like makes it possible. So just a second. Yeah, so like irrespective of what the other players are choosing, for player 1, for the ith player, his utility when he chooses strategy 0 is greater than equal to the utility when he chooses strategy 1, and the greater than equal to, like, only the inequality part is satisfied. Similarly, if he chooses strategy 1, then also the greater than equal to condition is satisfied. So again, every PSNE is also a very weakly dominant strategy equilibrium here. So like, did you get this? Hello, so was this point clear?
Yeah, makes sense.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, so this is a slight modification of the tragedy of commons problem. So the government now introduces a pollution tax of 5 units for every farmer who's keeping a sheep, right? So the new utility function becomes the SI, which is the gain due to keeping of sheep, and minus 5 SI because there's 5 unit tax per farmer who's keeping a sheep, and then this is the amount that the negative utility, which is the damage due to the environment, shared by everyone, right? So like in this case also, we can clearly see that the strategy 0 is better than strategy 1 in terms of utility for every player irrespective of what the other player chooses, right? So again, 0 is a strongly dominant strategy for each of the players, and 0,0 in this way is also a pure strategy Nash equilibrium, right? So like another question again, can you identify the dominant strategy equilibrium here? Yes, so did anyone get what is the dominant strategy equilibrium for this PSNE? Or like, is there none?
Is it 0,0,0,0?
No, I'm saying that this is the PSNE. So is this also a kind of dominant strategy equilibrium? Like we discussed the three dominant strategy equilibrium, right? Strongly, weakly, and very weakly. So is this strategy profile also a dominant strategy equilibrium?
Yes, I think.
So like which one then? Okay, so I'll explain. So see, irrespective of what the other players are choosing, if a player chooses the strategy 0, he's always better off than choosing strategy 1, right? Irrespective of what the other players are choosing. So clearly, 0 is the strongly dominant strategy for that player. This is what the definition of strongly dominant strategy says, right? And this is true for all the players because we consider any arbitrary I, and so it's true for all such n players, right? So 0,0,0 for everyone is a strongly dominant strategy equilibrium. So like, does that make sense?
Yes.
Yeah, okay. Okay, so now I'll be discussing another paradox, the Bray's paradox. So the problem goes like this. So like, we have a source and a destination denoted by the initial S and T. And there are two possible paths to go from S to T. The first path is from S to T via A, and the second path is from S to T via B, right? And the amount of time taken from the path for the path S to A is directly proportional to the number of vehicles going through that path at any moment, right? So it's m by 50, where m is the number of vehicles moving to the path s to a. And then for the time for a to t is constant. The time for traveling from a to t is constant and equal to 25 minutes. Similarly, for going from s to b, the time is constant and equal to 25 minutes. And from b to t, it's again proportional to the number of vehicles going through that path, and it's equal to m by 50. Okay, so now a new link is introduced from A to B, and the time that it takes for a vehicle to go from A to B is infinitely, it's like negligible, infinitesimally small, right? So like earlier, when no new link was introduced, each player had two strategies, right? He could choose S to T via A and S to T via B. So A comma B are the strategies in that case. And let's say there are total n number of vehicles, and we are considering 1000 for considering an example. And so NA plus NB would be 1000 in that case. However, when a new link is introduced from A to B, now there are three possible paths, SAT, SBT, and SABT, right? So each player has three strategies now, A, AB, and T. Okay, so A means path SAT, AB means path SABT, and B means path SBT, right? And in that case, NA plus NB plus AB would be 1000, right? So let's analyze the situation before any new link is introduced. Okay, so keep this, like this diagram in mind. So in that case, we are finding the utility relation for the ith player given a strategy profile S1 to SN. So it's minus 25. So if the player, ith player chooses to move via path A, so then the utility in that case is so minus 25. So since it's the time delay, we are again associating a negative sign with it. So A to T, it's minus 25 for this part, and minus M by 50. So where M is the number of vehicles which are going through path SAT, right? So that's minus 25 minus NA by 50. And similarly, if this ith player chooses strategy B, then this is minus 25 minus NB, where NB is the number of players or the number of vehicles choosing the path SBT divided by 50. So like, is this recurrent, is this utility relation clear? Yeah, so like, if no one has a doubt, then I'll proceed. So if we consider the situation, suppose all the 1000 players are going through the path SAT, right? All the 1000 vehicles are going through the path SAT. Then that case M would be 1000. Then so the time from S to A is 1000 by 50, which is 20 minutes, and from A to T is 25 minutes. So the overall time is 45 minutes. However, so each of the player knows that there is another path SBT also, right? So if one player from this 1000 player chooses to go via the path SBT, then he would be decreasing his time delay and hence maximizing his utility. So it's 25 plus 1 by 50, so something minus 25 point something for that player. So that way, some more players would, or more vehicles would divert to this path, and then a situation would come when there would be equilibrium between the two paths SAT and SBT. So like, how can we find the situation? So there would be equilibrium only if both the paths take same amount of time. So M by 50, that is NA by 50 plus 25 equal to 25 plus NB by 50. So the condition is NA equal to NB, right? So like, there should be equal division of all the vehicles, which is 505. Okay, so now we can argue that this configuration, all possible configurations where 500 vehicles are going through path A while other 500 vehicles are going through path B, constitute a pure strategy nash equilibrium. How? So let's assume that the first 1 to 500 players or vehicles have chosen path SAT and the other have chosen the path SBT. And we randomly select, say, player number 250 or the vehicle 250. If he chooses to change his path from SAT or to deviate from his path from SAT to SBT, then here only 499 vehicles would remain, and here in this path 501 vehicles would come, right? So for all these 499 vehicles, their time delay would decrease, because here instead of 500, it would be 499 here. And for the ith player who deviated from SAT to SBT, as well as for all the players which were already taking this path, their utilities would decrease because the time delay would increase. So it would be 25 plus 5 over 1 back, right? So we can clearly say that all such configurations where 500 vehicles follow the path SAT while other 500 follow the path SBT would be a Nash equilibrium, right? So like any doubt in this part? Okay, I guess there's no doubt. And so in the Nash equilibrium strategy profile, each player's time is the time it takes to travel from S to T. So here are 500 players go through this path. So it's 500 by 50, 10 plus 25. So minus 35 utility for each player, right? So now let's introduce the link AB. So now each player's strategy set contains three elements, AB and A comma B, and NA plus NB plus NAB is 1000, right? So now we're considering the utility given the three cases. So if the player I chooses the strategy A, that is travels through path SAT, then his utility would be minus 25 for the path from A to T. And this is for the path from S to A. So I'll start again. So NN are the number of vehicles going through the path SAT, and NAB are those going through the path SABT. So in this path from S to A, the total number of vehicles would be NA plus NAB, right? So that's what written here. If a player chooses the strategy A, then his utility would be minus 25 and minus NA plus NB by 50. And similarly, if the player chooses strategy B, his utility would be minus 25 minus. So again, on this path, the number of vehicles would be those choosing SBT, that is NB, plus those choosing SABT. So here NB plus NAB would come, right? So this is the utility in case the person chooses strategy B. And if the person chooses path strategy AB, so this is the path. So the total time is here, it's minus, or the total utility is negative of NA plus NAB by 50 plus NB plus NAB by 50, right? So I hope this part is clear. So now we can see from this utility table that irrespective of what the other player strategies are, for any player, choosing AB is always the best. Choosing AB profile always gives the best utility than choosing strategy A or strategy B. How? So let's compare the strategy A and B, A and AB, and their utilities first. So if a player is choosing strategy A, his utility is minus 25 minus this term. And this term is also present in the utility for the strategy AB. And there's this additional term in the strategy set of AB, which is NB plus NAB by 50. So now this number NB plus NAB can be maximum equal to 1000, because that would be the case when the number of vehicles to the path SAT would be 0. So this term would be always greater than equal to minus. So this term minus of NB plus NAB by 50, it would always be greater than equal to minus 20, because when this number is 1000, then it would be minus 1000 by 50 minus 20. However, in case NA is greater than 0, that is the number of vehicles to the path SAT, then this term would be less than 1000, and hence this whole term would be greater than minus 20. So we can clearly see that the utility when a player chooses strategy AB is greater than the utility when player chooses strategy A, irrespective of what the other players are choosing, right? Similarly, we can argue that the utility would be greater when the person chooses strategy AB, irrespective of what the other players are choosing. So AB now becomes, AB is a strongly dominant strategy for each of the players, right? So AB, AB for all players, this becomes a strongly dominant strategy equilibrium. Now, since it's a strongly dominant strategy equilibrium, it also is a PSNE, because a PSNE is a weaker notion than strongly dominant strategy equilibrium, right? So like logically, we would expecting each of the vehicle drivers are rational. We can expect that all the commuters will take this path AB, AB, AB once this link is open, right? But if this is the case, so what happens? All the 1000 players are going vehicles are going through that path, right? So in that case, what is the overall time delay? So 1000 by 50, which is 20, plus 1000 by 50, which is 20. So yeah, the total time becomes 40 minutes, or the utility becomes minus 40, which is even worse off than what was of the PSNE when the link was not opened. So when the link was not opened, the pure strategy Nash equilibrium was when 500 players followed one of the path SAT and the other 500 followed the path SBT. So in that case, the time delay was 35 minutes. Now, in this situation, when everyone is choosing the strategy AB, the time delay increases, so it becomes 40 minutes, right? So this is again evident that a pure strategy Nash equilibrium may not result in maximum utility for each of the players, or the sum of utilities may also not be maximum than from any other strategy profile. So like this thing is again evident here, right? And we can also argue that after this new link is introduced, right, we can say that NA equal to NB equal to 500, or the strategy profile, which was the pure strategy Nash equilibrium before introducing the link, this is now no longer the preferred strategy profile or the dominant strategy profile anymore. Why? Because let's suppose even after the new link is introduced, all the players, like 500 of the vehicles are going through the path SAT, while the other 500 are going through the path SBT. So each one of them have a total time of 45 minutes, right? Sorry, 35 minutes, right? However, if any one player changes his profile from SAT or SBT to SABT, let's say there were 500 people there and one vehicle chooses the profile SABT. So for him, the time delay would be, so it's 500 by 50, 10 plus 500 by 50. That's 20 minutes, which was earlier 35 minutes, right? So his utility has increased a lot, right? So that way we can argue that after the new link is opened, the each path having 500 vehicles or equal number of vehicles doesn't actually hold, because every commuter would act greedily and choose the Nash equilibrium strategy path, and then end up getting a worse payoff than what it was getting before, right? So this is the paradox, that the introduction of an additional link forces a strategy of AB on every vehicle, because it's a strongly dominant strategy, and assuming each player is rational and greedy, each one would take that path, and so it leads to more delay. So a path link which was opened so as to ease the traffic or decongest it now led to more time delay. So this is the paradox. So this was all about today's talk, and I hope you enjoyed it and got a thorough understanding of Nash equilibrium. So I'm open to doubts now if there are any, and I'd encourage everyone to tune in for the next session, where talk 3, where mechanism design will be covered. So if there are any doubts, you can unmute and ask. Hello, am I audible? So like, are there any doubts?
Like, can you once explain again the AB path utilities?
Yeah, okay. So you mean when the new link is introduced, the utilities when the new link is introduced, right?
Yes.
Yeah, so when the new link is introduced, then each player has three possible strategies, either to go through the path SAT or SABT or SBT. So SAT path is denoted by the strategy A, SABT by the strategy AB, and SBT by the strategy B, right? And so let NA be the number of commuters that are choosing the path SAT. So NA are the number of people go through the path SAT, and NAB are the number of commuters through the path SABT, and NB is the number of commuters through the path SBT. Okay, so now the utility function. So let's consider an arbitrary player I. So if that player is choosing the strategy SI equal to A, then the utility for that player would be, so here the total number of commuters would be those who are choosing the strategy SAT plus those who are choosing the strategy SABT, right? So it's NA plus NAB by 50 for this part. So, like, is this clear?
Yes.
Okay. So then utility for the path SAT is utility for this path plus utility for this path. That's minus 25 plus minus NA plus NAB by 50. And similarly, for path SBT, the utility, for example, a player chooses the path SBT, then his utility would be minus 25 plus, here the number of commuters is minus NB plus minus NAB. I mean, minus of NB plus NAB by 50. So this is the utility in that case. So it's clearly shown here, right? And then if a player chooses path SABT, so in this path, the total number of commuters are NA plus NAB, right? So the utility for this part is negative of NA plus NAB by 50. The utility for this path is negative of NB plus NAB by 50. So this is the overall utility for the path AB. Negative of NA plus NAB by 50 minus negative of NB plus NAB by 50. Okay, so like, is this clear? This how we got the utility for the strategy AB?
Yes, yes.
Yeah.
Like, how you interpret then, like, once
I explain. Yeah. So, like, let's compare the strategies, the utilities when we player chooses strategy A or when a player chooses a strategy AB, right? So, in case of strategy AB, so, like, we are considering that the other players, whatever their profile is, it doesn't matter, right? Because let's say if player I is choosing strategy AB, then and if in the, on the other hand, if he's choosing strategy A, then this part minus NA minus of NA plus NB by 50 is common in both the utilities, right? So the only difference is created due to this minus 25 and this minus of NB plus NAB by 50 part, right? Now,
yes,
we know that NA plus NB plus NAB, that is the total number of commuters following the three paths add up to 1000, right? So NB plus NAB, that is the total number of commuters to the path B and AB. So that could be a maximum of 1000, right? When we consider that extreme scenario when no one chooses the path SAT. So this term, so this NB plus NAB would always be less than equal to 1000. So negative of NB plus NAB would always by 50 would always be greater than equal to minus 20. So like, did you get this part?
Yes.
Yeah. So since this part is always greater than equal to minus 20, so it's always greater than equal to minus 25. So again, this utility, this expression is always greater than this expression, irrespective of what the NA, NAB and NB are, right?
Yes.
And same goes for the comparison of the strategies A, B, and B, right? So, like,
yes.
What we can conclude is that the strategy A, B is strongly dominant strategy for each of the players, irrespective of what the other players are choosing. Because we have chosen NA, NB, and NAB to be arbitrary variables. Like, we do not necessarily know what these values are. We consider them to be variables. So they could be any number, and depending on that, the S minus I for each player would change. That is, the strategy set of all the other players excluding that player would change. So considering this, so AB is the strongly dominant strategy for each of the player, right? So that is why AB comma AB comma AB for everyone is a PSNE and as well as a strongly dominant equilibrium. So like, is it clear now, like the doubt you had?
Yes, yes.
Okay. So does anyone have any other doubts? So like, if there are no doubts, then maybe we can conclude the session. So thank you for joining. I hope you enjoyed the session.